Good morning, everybody, and thank you for joining us today. My name is Dave McPhee, and I'm the Director of 3D Printer Sales here at Cimquest. So before we get into the presentation this morning on a MIM-based approach to metal 3D printing, I wanted to take a few minutes to introduce the audience to Cimquest. Actually, before I do that, I did want to just kind of take a quick housekeeping comment here. We certainly encourage questions and participation. There is in the chat function or the Q&A function, please feel free to put your questions in there. And at the end of this presentation, we'll be happy to answer any questions that you may have. So next slide, please. So who are we? So Cimquest are specialists in integrating engineering and manufacturing solutions, and we've been doing so since 1990. We've been selling and supporting MasterCam CNC programming software since day one. Today, we are the largest MasterCam reseller globally. In addition to MasterCam, which by the way is also the most widely used CNC programming software worldwide, we also provide a complete line of 3D scanning technologies and 3D printers. With 60 employees, we have several hundred years of combined engineering and manufacturing experience across multiple industries. We support customers all over the US, but the bulk of our business is really concentrated here in the Northeast and the Mid-Atlantic states. So obviously we've been selling and supporting 3D printing technology since 1995, before the phrase 3D printing was even coined. We feel that experience combined with our manufacturing DNA is why we are well positioned to help customers scale from product development to production in both plastics and metals. Next slide, please. So along that 28-year 3D printing journey, we learned that there is no one best fit technology. That is why today we represent 8 different 3D printer manufacturers. Combined, those manufacturers provide 9 different additive technologies. 4 of those are specific to metal printing, while 3 follow a very similar path to metal injection molding, which requires sintering to form into their final net near shape. Obviously, that'll be the basis for the presentation today. Next slide, please. So what is MIM? Metal injection molding is one of the more popular metal fabrication processes today and is ideal for the production of high volume products. The technology was introduced in the mid-1950s and has seen considerable advances since the early 90s. Companies often rely on MIM when creating metal parts with complex geometries and require consistency for large runs. Next slide, please. Metal 3D printing offers many of the same benefits as MIM for metal part production without the investment in time or cost of the MIM tooling. Another advantage of metal 3D printing is that the process lends itself to doing handfuls of parts as well as the ability to scale up to production depending on the technology used. Stefan, if you could do me a favor and just kind of go back one slide really quick. So what I wanted to point out here is, you know, with metal injection molding, essentially what you have is you have, you know, metal powder and a plastic binder that are mixed together. This feedstock is then introduced into, you know, an injection molding machine, very similar to plastic injection molding machine, where we're using a tool. Okay. When that part is molded, it comes out as something we call a green part. Okay, think of it like a really dense clay or like a kind of a dense crayon with metal particles embedded inside of it. Okay, and then from there it follows a process where it gets there's a two-part process where it gets debound either a solvent or a thermal. Turns into a brown part, and then finally that part goes through a sintering phase where the metal part is its final shape. Next, back to the next slide, please. So with 3D printing, essentially all we're doing is we're using the 3D printer to essentially replace that formation process, right? So we're eliminating the tooling required that goes into the injection mold. But from there, you'll see that it pretty much follows the same process, you know, green part, debind, and then, finally into the final sinter stage. Next slide, please. So as part of this webinar journey, we created a four-part series. Last week, we had BASF and Ultimaker give presentations. Both of those presentations are now on demand and will be available to anyone that's on this call. Today, we have DSH Technologies to present their portion of this presentation, which will also be recorded and available. And then on Thursday, we finish this series with Desktop Metal as they talk about how their process fits into the into the MIM journey. Okay, next slide, please. With that, I'd like to introduce Stefan Yerns, okay, who will be presenting today. And then along with myself and Jim Snodgrass will be helping me moderate and answer any questions that you guys put into the chat function. So really appreciate you all being here. And Stefan, I'm gonna turn it over to you. I think you're on mute, buddy.
All right, let's try that again. Thank you so much for the introduction. And I think that was a great synopsis of kind of where we came from in the MIM world and what we're doing now with 3D printing and how there's such a synergy in what happens after you actually get to a formed part, let's call it that way. Before we get started, I just want to, you know, welcome everybody to the presentation and the webinar. I look forward to walking you through what my slides are all about, which is basically from printed to sintered. And what is this process actually doing and how does it work? And what is, let's call it, the black box that this industry has? And my goal today is basically to make it a translucent box, a glass box, something you can see into. You can get an understanding of what this process actually is like and what are all the considerations you need to think about, you know, while you're designing your part, and then also how you're printing your part. And then from that point forward, how does this survive the process and get you to a, you know, a beautiful new metal piece that, you know, is not able to be printed any other way. So again, my name is Stefan Yerns. The presentation today, I'm gonna walk through an introduction, a little bit of the terminology, which Dave had dove into a little bit this morning. And then I wanna walk through debinding, brown part, something called a TGA, what is the plastic removal process and why is it so important? And then what happens with sintering and what happens after sintering? And then I do have a good, you know, four or five slides on what some process examples look like, some good ones and also some failures, so that, you know, I think failures are usually the best way to learn things. So we'll dive into that. And hopefully, you know, after today and then going forward, not only do you get a good understanding of what this process is, but you've also got to know myself and the rest of this crew here, where you have some resources to ask some questions too as you need help. So let's go into who I am. Hair's a little shorter now than you see in the image, but I'm currently the vice president of DSH, which is basically a process facility that also offers a bunch of process knowledge and debind and sinter technology training and information. I'm also the president of Elmic Systems, which is a debind and sinter equipment manufacturer. And I've been involved in this industry for metal injection molding and the metal powder industry for quite some time. Had some former board of director roles. I've been the chairman of a couple of different trade shows. I have one that's coming up in June. Action sports guy, love motivation, love quotes. Wood shop is also one of my other favorite things to do. So, and problem solving. So let's break down the terminology a little bit to give everybody a little understanding. So as I use these words later on throughout the webinar, there's a lot better understanding of what we actually have. So the first part is a green part. So what is a green part? The green part is what you actually have once you take the part off your printer. So it's full of wax, it's full of plastic, and it's full of metal powder. A brown part is what happens after you take the wax out of the part. So the only thing left is just the polymer and the metal parts. And the metal particles are actually being held together by that plastic polymer that's left behind. Debinding is actually the process of removing either the wax or the polymer from those metal particles before you move into what's considered the sintering stage, where you're actually fusing together the metal particles and making a hard, dense piece. Then there's a terminology called live setter, which I'm going to reference throughout the presentation here. And this is a really important one because for low volume or very challenging geometries, a live setter is basically a raft or a shape that's printed, which is there to support your part through the cycle that it needs to live, you know, before it becomes a hard, dense metal piece. And this is a really, really critical part. Because without it, as you'll see in some of the process examples, it won't allow the part to successfully make it through the stages it needs to survive. And typically a live setter is usually made of the same material that the part is printed of. And then there's something called an anti-sinter layer, which is basically if you print a live setter, you don't want to just rest your piece right on it because they will fuse together. You need to have some kind of ceramic coating between the live setter and your actual part so that later after it's sintered, you can either pull it apart or at worst case scenario, you might have to pry it apart with a little screwdriver or something, but almost always they come off really, really easy. But it prevents bonding between the two parts, both the live actual part and then the staging device. Okay, so once we have a printed piece, which let me go back to one thing real quick before we dive into first stage debinding. There's one thing I wanna make sure we as a community here of 3D printer part makers, we need to think about the process and the terminology the industry uses and make sure we're saying the words right. Once you print the part, you're still in process until you actually have a metal piece. The industry, there's a lot of talk around post-process after printing. The printed part is nothing different than an actual MIM piece in terms of it's got wax, plastic, and metal together. So we gotta be sure that we're talking about it as an in-process or part of the process, the debinding and the sintering. And I wanna make sure that terminology gets done, you know, and spread through the industry too. So what is debinding? So the first step in the case for the ultrafuse material, your wax-based material is something called polyacetal or POM in short. Then the secondary binder is typically a polyethylene, and then you have your metal powder. So what you need to do in this first step is we need to get the wax out of the part. So the way we do that is something called catalytic debinding for the ultrafuse material. And from an image perspective, I found these slides. The bottom is actually was provided by BSF. And what you're seeing is based on your part thickness, there's a certain amount of hold time you need to follow in order to be sure that all the polyacetal comes out of the piece. Visually, if you want to see it from the upper imagery, basically the top left side shows you your molded piece or printed piece where you have plastic, wax, metal, all kind of together in the shape and the form. When I take that first stage material away, I'm slowly eating away through this diffusion process all that pre-state polyacetal. And at the end, I'm left with my white circles, which is all my metal particles, but the little bit of black material left behind is all the plastic polymer, which doesn't come out in the catalytic step, holding all the metal particles together. So my goal of first stage debinding is to create this porosity channel throughout my part. So in the higher temperature furnace, I can actually let the polyethylene come out through that porosity channel and not make its own way out, which causes cracking and blistering and so forth. So this is a extremely critical step in the process. What does the catalytic debind oven look like? This is an example from Elnick. This is basically the unit. It stands up, it's about 4.5 to 5 feet tall. And then you have an open rack on the inside where you stage all your parts on trays. Nitric acid drips into a tray in the back, becomes a vapor, and that vapor circulates around that around the oven while getting heated, and that slowly, as in the previous image, begins to eat away at that polyacetal material until there's none left. And in the case of this material, in order to make sure from a quality perspective you've met the processing time, all these materials will have a weight loss requirement. So for the example of ultrafuse material, you need to be around a 10% weight loss, and then you know you've gotten all your polyacetal material out and you can advance to the next step. And that's a good quality step to put in place if you're doing that. If you outsource this process, this is typically what's done. This is what we do at DSH. There is another form of debinding. This doesn't directly apply to the ultrafused material, but if there's other types of MIM parts or in the 3D printing world, instead of a catalytic process, you might want to use something called a solvent process if it's a different type of wax, just to be open and make sure we have a good understanding of what this industry basically does and how it works. So this would be a solvent. You'd have something like a paraffin or a carnauba wax basically holding your material together. So once we get the first material, the polyacetal, out of the piece, now I'm left behind with what's called a brown part. And a brown part, as I mentioned earlier, is basically your polyethylene or your plastic still holding together your metal particles. As you see in this imagery here, the round parts are your metal particles, but all this like sticky, tacky, web-like material between it is the plastic that's still behind. And this is an image of a, you know, an SEM showing what a typical MIM part is. I don't have an example of this for an ultrafuse or a 3D printed part, but the concept is the same. So once you get to this piece, what's next, right? How do we get the plastic out of the piece and how do we actually fuse the metal together? What is this process? This is what's called thermal binder removal. And thermal binder removal is basically the diffusion of the polymer, the plastic, through all that open porosity that we created by removing the first stage wax. Now, what's critical to know here is the longer this L dimension goes, or the thickness or cross section of the part, the longer the bigger the cross section is, the longer you need to hold at the temperature to get the plastic out of the piece. And as you see with these little arrows, what we're doing is we're letting the material, the vapor, kind of hit the surface of the part. So the best example I always like to describe this as is think about sitting in front of a bonfire. And you have all these dry logs you've been putting in the fire, it's all good. You're getting a little low on your supply, but you still have a couple of logs that sat out in the rain for a couple of days. And you're like, well, I don't want to put it right in the fire because it's going to smoke everybody out. Is there a way I can dry these parts? So if you put that log next to the fire on the outside of it, close enough to the heat, it's going to get to a point where it heats up enough where the water vapor that's inside that log begins to become a smoke, and you can see that kind of raising away from the log. That's basically your debinding the log of the water vapor that's inside it. So if you think about the piece that you've printed that's now in the larger furnace, debinding is this same concept. You're getting to a temperature where the material that's inside the part gets warm enough where it becomes a vapor. And as you see here, right, we have vapor on the surface of the piece. In a furnace use, basically you're either pushing or pulling gas across that product to pull that vapor away from the part that's inside that piece. And then once you've held long enough, again, it's all based on the cross section of the part. And the other little factor that plays into it is particle size distribution. I won't spend a lot of time here because with the ultrafuse, it's all kind of dialed in for what works. But if you have, you know, some larger particle sizes versus some really, really small particle sizes, the concept here is basically the smaller the particle size, the smaller the porosity, the smaller the channel for the vapor to come away, right? So it's just going to take longer. The example I like to use here is if somebody were to go get a big, you know, ice drink like a Slurpee from 7-Eleven, and you get the standard Slurpee straw, it's nice and big and round, it's got a big opening. You can probably drink that in a certain amount of time. Where if I give you a cocktail straw to drink the same drink, it's going to take you a lot longer. So think about that when you're thinking about particle size and distributions, if that's ever something you get involved in playing with. But this is the concept of thermal binder removal. So once we start getting this material out of here, how do we determine what temperature we actually need to do this at? So like I said, with BSF, you're pretty much dialed in. They've, you know, put all the work into ahead of time to make sure this material is really consistent. It processes the same way. There's a recipe dialed in. But if you ever get down the road and you're starting to experiment with things like this, or even how did BSF get to this place, you do something called a TGA, or thermogravimetric analysis. And basically what this is, you're taking your brown part, it sits on a scale in a furnace, and as the vapor, the polymer, gets removed at a certain temperature, that scale is changing. The weight of that part is basically changing based on that scale. So as you see here, 100, 200, 300, my C temperature is across the X-axis and my weight is across the top. it doesn't really start changing weight till around 350 degrees. So that's the temperature where polyethylene actually starts to become a vapor. And at that point is when the part starts to lose weight and you start to see the weight of the part dropping drastically till around 450. And then I'm no longer losing weight because I've lost all the polymer that's holding my metal together, right? So basically when you're looking at something called a TGA, you wanna look for the steepest section of the curve and you wanna put a hold in your recipe at that temperature. So this is around 420, 25 degrees. Now I just know I have a part that's 5 millimeters, 10 millimeters, 20 millimeters, based on the part thickness, that's how long I need to hold at that temperature. So once you're done with your debinding, what happens, right? Once there's no more polymer holding this material together, at that 450 to 500 degrees is where the in this case, mostly stainless steel, it begins to tack together really, really slowly, which visually you can see up here between these necks forming between the metal particles. That's actually what's holding your part together. And what you have to realize is at this stage, the part is almost at its complete weakest. So you need to make sure, like I said earlier, with supporting, the part needs to be well supported. So as it gets to a point where it fully bonds together, it's being cradled and held in place. And there's not gravity pulling away from the particle and so forth, which I'll show you in the part examples later. But sintering is basically the art of fusing the metal particles together. You can think about it kind of like welding, but you're not melting the material. I always like to use the analogy is if I had a glass of water and I took two drops of water, put them on a table next to each other, if they were close enough, they would bond and become one particle or one drop of water. In sintering, that's kind of the concept, but you don't want to go full liquid because then you'll just have a big, flat, odd-looking paperweight that you'll take out of your furnace and it's not going to be something you want to keep around or really display to anybody. So the goal is how do I get as close to the melting point of the metal without disturbing the structure of the metal particles. So all I want is the surface of the metal particle to get soft enough where it bonds with the one next to it, but the core is still hard and dense. It doesn't reach anything like a liquid or melting point. Just the outer surface begins to bond together. And as you see the progression across the bottom, you form these bonds, you form what's called a grain, and then eventually this thing becomes one mass of a part with tiny little pores that are closed because there's always little factors that play into why things don't fully fuse together because you're not going fully liquid, right? So that's really the art of sintering. So just to keep things open and informative, as we like to do, what are the different types of furnaces that this industry actually provides to you? So there's something called a tube furnace down at the bottom. You're typically limited in atmosphere or pressure or vacuum control. You're definitely limited on part size. Most tubes in the industry are only 4 or 6 inches in diameter. The next opportunity would be to get into something called a box furnace, which would be more of a atmosphere only type furnace. So no vacuum control, a little bit harder to control the total atmosphere and the end result of the product. Then Elnick makes something called a vacuum or partial pressure furnace. There's other available systems out there as well. This furnace is going to give you a larger variety of atmospheres that you can operate under, a lot more control of the process, and you're always pulling the gas across your product, which is aiding in the most efficient way to remove the binder material versus trying to push it out. And then if you really, really want to set up a facility to make a bunch of parts, and you got a whole farm of 3D printers ready to go, and you're making everything, you can get involved in something called the continuous furnace. So you need a lot of volume to move things through a continuous furnace. In the MIM world, you're typically looking at things like 400,000 or 500,000 parts a year or more, because these things want to continuously churn product. The three options I showed you earlier are typically more for your smaller setup, your turn on, turn off type of system. Those are your main options if you're looking to invest in equipment yourself. The last option, or the other alternative, let's say, is basically what DSH does. And what we offer is a toll debind and sinter service. So through BSF and the UltraFuse program, there's coupons per weight of product that comes to our facility. We process and return them within a week. Or if you have a large enough volume of parts and you want to dedicate your own runs, those are things you can certainly do, whether it's DSH or any other type of toll debind and sinter provider that's available, of which there's not many in the world. Okay. Once you have your piece, it's sintered, it's good, you like the way it looks, you've checked your density, everything meets what it needs to, there's something called post-sintering operations. So this is actually post-process work. There's something like polishing. If you need to get a really nice surface to it, you can bead blast to clean the surface up. Case hardening would be like a post-process heat treat type step. You can add threads. One thing to think about is you can actually do work on what's considered the green piece in like a soft jaw vise setup. So you can actually drill holes, put threads in there. You just have to accommodate for what the shrinkage is. So the one thing I didn't highlight earlier is from the printed dimension to the sinter dimension, you're losing around 20% of the size of the product. So you have to oversize your part, and that's typically all involved in the guideline documentation from BSF. And then the rest of the information down here. Hipping, for anybody who wants to know what that is basically what's considered hot isostatic press. So a lot of the jewelry part makers or people that really require 100% density of the product, hipping is basically a furnace process. You go to about 1,000 to 1,200 degrees, depending on your metal, and you go really, really high in pressure to force all the little porosity out of that product. And then Corning is a little bit of an older technology, but it's shaping. You basically reshape the part, bend and form it back into the place that it needs to be. All right, I'm going to get into some process examples. I got good examples and I got bad examples. And I want to walk through each and every one of these so everybody understands clearly kind of what these look like. So this is an example up here of the green printed part. This looks like it was some threaded cap with an end cap to it. I'm not exactly sure where this part was used. This is the part out of the catalytic debind process, and then this is the part out of the furnace. So you can see it's silver, it's shiny, not shiny, but it's silver, nice and clean. And the part survived itself quite well because there wasn't a lot of weight in this piece. And the next part I show you is going to be almost the same piece. And then that piece is going to show failure because it's a much taller piece of the same design. Here's an example of that. So roughly the same concept, a little bit of a different inside. But as you can see, after the catalytic debind step, this part started to fail. And the reason it failed is if you look underneath this piece, it's a little hard to see, but you have a geometry where you start to make a shoulder go out and then you have all this weight going vertically in the walls of this piece. That's a lot of weight for this thing to support itself as you're removing the material that's holding the stuff together before the metal's actually fused. So it's really critical that if you want to do something like this, you need to either add support structures or, like in the previous example, you probably need to redesign what your expectations are and maybe add something to it later through a welding step or something along those lines. But this is a good example of how this can be successful versus some of the challenges and failures you can have. One of the things you'll see in a later slide, and I like to say it all the time, is gravity always wins, right? So make sure you're considering that, you know, when you go forward. Here's another example of a failure. It's a beautiful piece that was printed, right? But you got to look at this. You got a little, you know, base structure and then these two Y tubes that come off the outside. By the time we went through catalytic debind, this part pulled itself apart. Right? When you remove the first stage material, there's only a little bit of plastic left behind holding the metal powder together. Gravity was pulling this thing apart. If we built a support structure to go up the side of this as a live setter, or maybe printed it in a different orientation, it might have survived. And I have an example of something quite similar in a way that actually survived in the next slide. And now you see this tube. What this customer did is they actually put a bit of a webbing between the two Ys of the tube in order to keep that thing from pulling apart. As I said before, this thing's going to shrink about 20% roughly, right? So in that shrinking process, when it's coming together, friction is also a factor you have to take into account. That's where this live setter concept or a raft of the product really helps, because the raft will take the friction and not let the part be the one that takes most of the friction. But this piece, I wish I grabbed one from the side to show a little better, but this shows you a little bit more of a webbing that was put between that part to help it pull together, right? Similar part, similar construction, flipped over, used, you know, the two legs to help it become more successful. this is a hard piece to do. So one of the things I always encourage customers to do is, if this is something you want to do, before you just go print it, reach out to people that are in the industry that would be helpful to answer questions about, how do I properly design this thing? DSH does that for its customer base. BSF and the Ultimaker team do a really good job there. And so does Cimquest, because they got experience. So definitely always ask questions before you just go print it, because the last thing we like to do is to show these images to the customers and then people get disappointed. There's a lesson learned here, right? But we would love to get involved in the early stages so that we can try to get a win for you as soon as possible. All right, let's walk through some other examples. This is a great example of what a live raft is with what we call an anti-sinter layer. So this top piece is printed. The bottom piece is printed as a raft. As you can see, it was minimized a little bit in terms of its total weight. There was added some porosity to it all. But we coated this with a spray. Now at DSH, we have two options. We can either paint on a ceramic layer, or we have a ceramic spray that we can use. And that spray, in this case, is what's going to allow this piece, as you see over here on the right side, the sintered part, to actually be pulled apart after the processing is done. If we didn't do that, this piece and the bottom piece would be fused together. Now, what's critical here about this live setter is, anything that typically has a C shape or something that's open, if you just let that sit on the ceramic as it shrinks, that shape is going to deform as it comes down into its final dimension. Where by putting that live plate underneath it, the live raft, the raft takes the shrinking stress and the part stays with it. So it doesn't have this need to reshape it later on. So this is a really good example of how to use a live raft in a design of a part that can be a little challenging without such a thing. All right, here's another example of a part that did not really survive so well through the process. Excuse me real quick, I just have a Ring Central call coming in on my computer, close that out. All right, so this is another beautiful part that was printed. Bit of a manifold, couple different inlets and outlets, did have a live setter underneath it. But here's again where gravity wins. You got a lot of weight on these shoulders up here on the top. And because it was all left hollow underneath for the reason of what this thing was doing, this part didn't survive, because as this material, again, as you move and remove the plastic in the wax, you got to get to a high enough temperature for the metal to begin to tack together. And in that process of removing these things, the part becomes more and more fragile. So if this is something you want to make as a design, you got to make sure you put some kind of support structures in place for these areas that are unsupported. Again, this would be a great example of working together with people in the industry who have success and have shown it work, can help kind of make this work out better in the long run. All right, we got another one. This is a great example of how gravity wins, right? So beautiful piece. This was one of the really, really, really good quality printed part. But if all this weight hanging off the outside of this wall, the wall, for the most part, stayed intact, but this part, unsupported, as you can see, fell off during the first stage of debinding. If we were to build some kind of support structure underneath here, or put in some kind of gusseting or something along those lines, this part would have a chance of surviving the whole process. Beautiful printed piece. Sadly, it didn't make the process, you know, didn't survive through it. So this is where it becomes very critical to know what happens after the print. Why is it so important to pay attention to gravity? We did help this customer redesign the part, and we were able to successfully process this part for them. But sadly, we didn't get the final picture for that one. Here's another example for you of a very, very thin piece. So thin parts, this is the printed, this is the sinter. They did use a live raft. We put the ceramic layer between it. Thin parts, typically really, really long thin parts, they struggle to come together. This is where using that live raft becomes a really good use of the process, where they would be hard to make this any other way. And there's a multiple examples of these Y tubes you can see underneath here, sintered. They did eventually go convert over to a live raft just to help. But every single one of these have successfully processed and worked through the technology of what we have here. And it worked really, really, really well. All right, so what are the things that can sinter to consider when you're actually going through this debind and sinter process? As I said earlier, gravity always wins, right? Everybody knows that. That's a pretty pretty good, easy physics law to understand. The other thing that's really important is how you print it is how you need to actually process it, orientation based. So for example, these tubes were printed in the vertical direction. If I take that tube and put it horizontally in the furnace process, typically when you print parts, the X and the Y has a certain level of consistency, but the Z, because you're not compressing material together, you're just printing layer on top of layer, there's not a lot of compression that takes place there. So if I take a part that is printed in the Z orientation and lie it on its side in the furnace, the shrinkage direction now is in the area where there's the least amount of compression. So you're adding a challenging variable of friction to that part sintering together. So always consider how you print it needs to be the same orientation you're putting it in the furnace. Again, if you have questions, we're always here to help. And then where and how possible, try to use live setters. They are going to, without a doubt, help reduce the friction the part's going to see across the way. All right, moving over into DSH to give a little bit of a visual. This is what DSH's facility looks like. There's two Elnick medium-sized production furnaces within DSH. On our left side, we have a different style solvent debind oven. And then on the right over here, you can't see in this left image, it's kind of tucked in the corner here behind this light. That's where our catalytic debind oven is. So when parts come in from all the people in the industry that's using Ultrafuse, we use our nice, big, huge staging table. We put everything together, unbox, take photos as it's unboxed. We take photos as it's staged for debinding. We take photos after debinding, and then we take photos after the sintering process so that we can capture the entire process chain visually and then give customers the ability to see that while we generate a processing report where you can see the different stages that are going on. And typically with the processing report, we provide, you know, some recommendations or maybe why it failed, what we would do different. If we're going to make this part again, these are things and considerations we would take into account. And then, like I said, we're always there available for a phone call or an email to talk it through. DSH is a facility, like I said, that does a lot of process work for customers, whether you're small production or you're doing this Ultrafuse style program, which is an amazing, and currently that I can say from being in this industry long enough, the lowest cost approach towards making a metal part with a 3D printing technology. It's really, really amazing what BSF is offering through the help of Altimaker and companies like Cimquest supporting the process also, you know, from a knowledge SharePoint perspective. But we also do a bunch of different process education work. So as you advance in the technology, as you advance in the world, as you advance in this, you know, this industry, this is really what DSH does. We love diving into the science. We love diving into technology. We love diving into new designs. All this stuff really gets our excitement going. So any way we can help, this is stuff we've been doing for over 20 years in this industry, and we really, really enjoy it. So it's been a pleasure to walk you through a little bit about what debind and sinter technology is. Now, I'd love to move it over to a Q&A time and answer any questions you all have. So thank you so much for the time.
All right, thank you so much. So I will start reading out some questions here. We've received a few so far. Again, if anyone has questions, you can use the questions function or just put it right in the chat. So to start, how does the BASF Ultrafuse program for debind and sinter processing work?
Great question. So typically the Ultrafuse material, so the filament will be purchased either mostly directly from a distributor like Cimquest or anyone in your local region, depending on where you are across the world or the United States. Once you get the material in-house, you need to print the parts that you have. Like I said earlier, I highly encourage people, if they have challenging designs that are a little bit outside the guideline perspective of what BSF recommends, give us a call. Let's talk this out. Let's make sure we try to get a win right away, you know, versus trying to have to learn some lessons. So once the part's printed, either a coupon is purchased with the filament for debinding and sintering, or you can get that from one of the local distributors as well. And that coupon is basically, it's $50 for 1 kilogram of processing. That does include return shipping within the United States. If it's outside the United States, there will be, we need to work out a different shipping arrangement, you know, locally with that customer. So once you put the parts together and you print them, then you need to ship them to DSH Technologies here in New Jersey. And there's two rules we have for shipping. First one is make sure they're not rubbing against another part or rubbing against something within the box. And then the other thing is make sure that the parts don't rattle within the box. You can put four levels of bubble tape around it, but if it still shakes around inside the box, it's not really that protected. So make sure that the parts don't rub and they don't rattle, and you put them in a box. Don't just put them in a bubble envelope. That's not going to make it survive. Everybody knows what UPS and FedEx does with stuff when they see this stuff shipping out. So once you get the parts over to us, we process the second and the fourth Tuesday of every month. We need them the Friday before so we can get everything staged. So Tuesday we debind, Wednesday we sinter, and then Thursday we package and we ship them out either Thursday or Friday.
Awesome. Okay. Next question is, what are some considerations when packaging green parts for shipping to DSH?
Great question. Highlighted a little bit of that in the last one, but let's reiterate it because it is really, really important. They shouldn't rub against each other. So don't put three parts in a bag because they can rub against each other and they can rub material away. Put them individually, wrap them in bubble wrap or put them in some kind of foam. Slitting into foam if you have thinner parts is a really good idea. And then make sure whatever you package in the box doesn't rattle when you shake the box. Just make sure it's packed and it's cradled as best you can. Those are the two main guidelines we have for shipping parts. And if you got questions, again, always ask before you just go do.
Perfect. Okay. Next up is, what's the biggest difference between MIM and metal 3D printing when it comes to processing parts for debind / sinter?
Another good question. So MIM versus 3D printing, material wise, you're about the same. There's a little bit more first stage binder in the ultrafuse material. But the biggest consideration is what I highlighted a little bit earlier. In MIM, because you're pressing material into a mold, you have compression of all that material. So you have a much more uniform part in terms of what it's going to do from a shrinkage perspective through its life cycle. When you're doing 3D printing, your XY shrink rate is typically the same, but your Z shrink rate is always going to be a little bit more because you're not pressing that material together. Yeah, there's a little bit of smearing kind of technology that's being pressed down, but not enough to allow it to really have consistency and shrink rate. And like I said earlier, you need to make sure that the print orientation matches the way you're going to put it in the furnace. Otherwise, you're adding more friction as that part needs to shrink together. It's going to try to pull apart versus move together. So that would be the biggest, you know, the biggest difference between the two.
Awesome. Okay. Next is, what are some tips for ensuring the success of a filament printed part surviving debind and sinter?
Supporting, making sure, you know, looking at it from a perspective, if there's a big overhang like that one part I showed, more often than not, it's probably going to pull itself away. If it's just a thin little wall that's hanging there, it's one thing, but if it's got enough mass to it, it's going to pull away. So always think about the part. If it, in your head, visualize how can it fall apart, right? If it's just standing upright, can it go fall apart that way? If it can, either you need to put some tie bars in place, maybe gusset the material a little bit more. So what you need to think about with additive manufacturing and 3D printing, think about it as, yes, I'm making a part that is probably really challenging to make any other way additively, but always consider the fact you're going to have to do some subtractive. In most cases, you're going to have to anyways. So you're better off adding some part design that's either acting as a support or making a support with a anti-sinter layer for that process.
Okay, next we have, what is the strength of a metal printed MIM-like part compared to traditional machining?
Well, you're not achieving raw material, right? So, but you're getting really close. I mean, you're getting 98, sometimes 99% density. If you need harder parts, you can go through a hardening process. So if hardening is really critical, I would lean towards the UltraFuse 17-4 based material. The other option of a 316 is your more corrosion resistance, a little softer base material, but you can get really, really close to, you know, raw material and machined parts. But you're, again, you have to consider you're making something with a technology that allows you to make what currently cannot be made. So that's the way I would approach it, and you can get quite close.
All right. It looks like we have a good handful of questions still coming in. So next up we have, can these parts be post-processed, machined, et cetera? You may have touched on this earlier, but just to reiterate.
Yeah, absolutely. They both can be. I would highly encourage, if you want to consider even pre-machining that stuff in once it's printed. If you can do it, if you got the right material, if it makes sense to do it, again, let's take a look at it. It can certainly be done. Post-machining is absolutely doable. It's as close as you can get to raw material. You just have little spots of porosity in place where, depending on what you're trying to achieve, it might cause a problem. But again, each part is typically a little bit unique. You got to just look at it.
Okay. Any options for tool steel like H13 or P20?
There are options in the industry. There's definitely some on the binder jet side of printing. Currently for UltraFuse 316 and 17-4, the opportunities that they have. Listen, BSF is a large company. They're certainly playing with other materials and trying to find the right way to bring it to market. But right now, those are the two options for UltraFuse. If you want other materials, there's other opportunities in the industry, in the market that you have to go to. And you know, if we can help, or Cimquest or any one of the other groups, we can point you in that direction. But stay in touch with BSF. Over the years, they're going to certainly be adding more material to it.
Yeah, I'll piggyback that one, Stefan. So, Evan, you said H13, and what was the other one?
P20.
Yes. Yeah. So, I mean, like, there's, yeah, like Stefan said, the UltraFuse material right now comes in 316 and 17-4, you know, they'd have to be the ones to answer what their material roadmap looks like, but there are tool steels available with other metal printing technologies. And, you know, like I said, in the beginning of the presentation, we represent four different technologies, right? And H13 and M300 and as well as D2 are a couple of the materials that pop out right off the top of my head that we have available, right? So that could be a bigger conversation.
Yep.
All right, next up we have, how should one go about the thermogravimetric analysis? Where should we start, and how does the process change if there are different alloys that allow or that you are processing in your sintering furnace?
Great question. So that sounds like a couple parts to it, and I'll break it down. So in order to do a thermogravimetric analysis, you need the equipment, right? Most places, it's not a simple, easy, low-cost piece of equipment to buy, and your volume of doing it is probably going to be so low, there's no reason to invest. So working with DSH, we have a couple partners we work with that do TGAs for us. A lot of local universities can also do TGA work if they have a material science lab. So I would reach out to a couple of different connections there, and that would be the process. Like I said, the UltraFuse material is already dialed in. So you don't need to do this kind of work, because unless you're actually trying to build your own recipe of debinding within equipment you have, you don't need to go do TGAs unless you're trying to solve a problem or learn something. So if you're experimenting with other materials and other suppliers or other things in the industry, a TGA is a great tool. Once you consistently use the same binder material and nothing changes, you don't need to actually redo TGAs. It's only once you do new things you need to experiment there. The next part of the question was regarding how does that change if we do different alloys. So the most important thing to know is when you're doing a sintering process run, you only want to do the same material. Now, 17-4 and 316 can be done together because the temperatures are close enough. And if you hold longer with the 316, you can typically get, you know, the same results as if you go 20 degrees higher in temperature. But you don't want to mix alloys in a furnace when you're doing sintering together. That's definitely one thing you need to consider. But if the particle sizes are the same and the binder is the same, if you're doing, you know, 4140 or 8620 steel based or an H13 or a stainless steel, if my metal particles are all the same size and the distribution is the same and the binder is the same, the TGA should actually give you very similar results.
Perfect. Okay. Next up we have, will hipping make parts watertight?
That's a good question. Hipping can certainly assist in adding to the water tightness of parts. The most important thing you need to consider when you're thinking about water tightness is you don't want to have open porosity in your sintered part. So most good MIM parts and 3D printed parts, you're looking, and it's okay to have closed porosity. And that's, you know, either done through X-ray or taking a look at the density measurements and so forth. if you're concerned, HIPping will not solve an open pore problem, but it will solve a closed pore problem. So a lot of parts actually as MIM'd or 3D printed here through the ultrafuse, you can actually achieve a watertight part through the regular standard processing without needing to go into a HIP process.
Great, okay. And we have one more question right now. So that would be, will parts pass liquid penetrant, magnetic particle, ultrasonic, X-ray testing after they're processed?
That's a loaded question. I like that one. And it kind of talks into what I said before. You can, it can pass a lot of these. The biggest thing is, what does it need to achieve? And what is the end use of the product? X-ray will certainly, you know, show you and demonstrate to you whether or not you have good quality of your process. Liquid penetrant, same question as the watertight kind of concept. So long as you have good closed porosity in your product, you should pass, you know, all the protocols that you need to process there. Magnetic, 316 is typically not magnetic unless you got something that mixed with it. 17.4 can be a little magnetic. So again, depending on what your end use is, it's hard to give a blanket yes or no to those, but it should, because I know those process steps have been used, you know, in some of the parts that have been used and processed here at DSH.
Okay, so that was the last question we had. Just to wrap up, thank you everyone for coming. I just want to point out that we have one more session, again, that is on Thursday, June 8th at 11 a.m. Eastern Time, Eastern Standard Time. That'll be with Desktop Metal. If anyone has any questions that maybe they think of later, you can always email us or reach out directly to Stefan there, and we'll be happy to answer them. Does anyone else have anything to finish up here?
Great questions today. I love the audience participation, and I love the questions, and I'm really appreciative of Stefan basically being able to answer all of them.
Yeah, it's my pleasure, guys. I thank you guys also for the opportunity to be here with you and, you know, support your audience and support the network we're trying to grow here in this industry. Listen, this is certainly a unique technology. It's something that is still young, but it has an extremely bright future. The most important thing to remember is if you can think what the process requires, you know, from start to finish, you can start to design the part specifically for what you're trying to do. And don't just go replace a technology with 3D printing because you can. Open up opportunities because you can do things that current technologies can't do for you. And that's the most important thing to think about and to get the most excited for. So I wish you guys all the best. This industry is going to certainly grow and become something phenomenal for us over the next 3 to 5 years. Lean on the people that are in the industry to help get it over the finish line. That's the most important part for you. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you all. Great job, everyone. And we will see the rest of you in 2 days. Take care.
Thanks, everybody.